Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you.
Walla Camp Meeting. My name is Dan Solis. I'm on the staff here at the Village Church, and joining me is Mike Barnett, the pastor of City Church. Mike has also been the speaker for our morning meetings throughout the week, and I know that you have received a blessing morning, evening. It's been a wonderful, wonderful camp meeting. We want to say thanks to a few people today, and first of all, thanks to Matt and Josie. They're going to be presenting during the service, but also we'll get to hear them in concert this evening at 6:30. So you'll want to put that onto your calendar. What else do we have, Mike?
Well, I'd like to say a special word of thanks to Theodore Levtaroff. He's done an amazing job sharing nuggets with us regarding Ellen White and then a number of seminars. Thank you so much, Theodore. We're glad to have you here. And of course, we're happy that all of you have come to join us and enjoy a rich blessing from God today.
We want to say a word to those of you who are watching by way of television or streaming through the internet. We're glad that you're joining us, but the programs this afternoon and this evening can only be enjoyed if you come and join us here. Our location is 715. Southeast 12th Street in College Place, Washington. And so we're going to be telling you about some other things that are going to be taking place, but you'll have to be here to enjoy them. So consider that our invitation. Come early to get the best seats. We also want to thank Teacher Tammy, Dr. Tamara Randolph, who has been presenting our children's feature from evening to evening. Dr. Randolph was one of my son's professors when he was a student at Walla Walla University, so a personal thank you for her encouragement for David.
And I'd like to also thank Cheryl Fetter and Cheryl Kennedy for their signing for Hearing Impaired. I appreciate their ministry. I'd like to thank Stan Wallace, who is doing special music, has his involvement. We appreciate him. And I'd like to take just a second to thank the Village Church, all its staff, both volunteer and paid. Since I'm from another congregation, I want to thank you for all the organization that you've put into it and for hosting us. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And thank you for coming. What would it be if you weren't here? May God bless richly as we continue to worship together this morning. And as we sing together.
Hymn is O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing, hymn number 250. Please stand.
My gracious Master and my God.
if possible, would you kneel with me as we seek the Lord in prayer? Father God, what a glorious Sabbath day. Time spent here with you, with your people, on a grander scale. And we thank you so much for bringing us together and being with us. Father God, we come to you with our praises, our thanks for all that you've done for us this week, for all that you've done for us during camp meeting. We thank you for giving us protection, providing for our needs, blessing us with spiritual insight and a greater love for you. And Father, today we bring you also our cares. We know this powerful hymn, "Does Jesus Care?" And we have found that he does. And thank you so much for caring for each of us. Would you bless us this morning? Draw us closer to yourself and help us to be more like you, that we too might be missionaries, whether or not we are doing so voluntarily, involuntarily, intentionally, unintentionally. We want to let our light shine. Please bless us with that grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Today's offering is for tithes and church budget. Now, if you're a member of the Village Church, you might know that one of those items on the church budget is prison ministries. And I want to share with you an update on prison ministries. The last 2 weeks, 19 young men have joined this church through baptism. People like Jason, who for the last 2 years has been searching the scriptures, trying to understand and know for sure that he could be forgiven, took a step to be baptized. People like John, who I was talking with yesterday, for the first time in his life, was able to write a check for tithe out of his meager funds. People like Robert, who after being put off by his family, said, "I am going to surrender it all. I only want Jesus." Is that good news? That is what general funds to the local church budget go for. I can't think of anything better to give your money for. Will the deacons please stand as we pray? Our loving Father in heaven, thank you for giving us an opportunity to participate with you in ministry. Your Holy Spirit is working remarkably among the people in this valley, across the world. And we pray that the funds that are taken in today will be used for the specific purpose of bringing more people into your kingdom before it's too late. That is our prayer, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning again. We'd like to invite the younger set in the congregation to come down. And today we have a little change of program, so we'd like for you to gather on the organ side rather than the piano side. So young people, come forward. Now we have a tradition here that we collect an offering as the children bring the offering forward that goes to help with children's ministry and is a blessing to children throughout the Walla Walla Valley. So if you will be generous with them as they come forward, and they will be very courteous to you and say thank you for supporting the children of our area. Today, we'd like to mention some things that are taking place. And first of all, I'd like to mention once again that at 6:30 this evening here in this auditorium, in this room, we will be blessed with a concert from Matt and Josie. Now, you're going to hear them in just a few minutes, but you'll be able to hear them for an extended period this afternoon beginning at 6:30. Mike, what else do we have going on here?
Well, we have a number of Sabbath seminars that are taking place this afternoon from 3 to 5 o'clock, and I'd like to give them an opportunity to just say a word. In fact, one of them is from 2:30 to 4. This would be a mission feature from Esther and David Coquille.
Hi, guys. So if you've never been out of the U.S. or have never been to Asia, this is your time to come along at 2 o'clock sharp. Don't be late. Don't be asleep. If I see you sleeping in the pews, don't worry. I will come and personally wake you up. We're going to Cambodia, we're going to Burma, we're going to Thailand, Philippines, and Sri Lanka. You don't need to bring your passport, and the Department of Homeland Security will never know you left the building.
We also have an outreach opportunity, and the outreach coordinator here at Village Church is going to be telling us about this activity.
Thank you, Pastor Dan. Sure, we're going to do a little door-to-door work and do a survey. And many of you know that it's hard to get Bible studies by doing surveys going door-to-door. But that's not the primary focus of what we'll be doing this afternoon. We're going to teach you how to do a survey that's really focused on finding out who in your community is interested in the programs that you're already offering at your church. Getting an email address for them so that when you have a Christian concert or a health seminar or a family program, when Pathfinders is starting up, it's absolutely free to invite everybody that's already said, hey, we'd like to know when that's happening. And so if you want to come out, we'll give you a little instruction on how to do a community interest survey at your own church and how to be effective going door to door.
Now, my good friend John here forgot he's going to be telling them about summer camp, right?
Sure, yeah. Yeah, that's something that's going on. That actually is on the community interest survey. But anything that's going on at your church is something that you'd want to put on your survey. But yes, we will be making sure people know about
it. I just wanted to make sure.
Chuck Hagley is also going to be doing an afternoon seminar. Chuck?
In the last 31 years, Project Patch has been working with families and kids that are under attack. And what we've seen is that the attack is becoming more focused and more furious. And what that leaves a lot of us is that we leave the point feeling scared, we watch the news, and we're not sure what to do. But what I want to share this afternoon is that God has a plan, He has a method, and many of us, if we can take the time to learn what God is doing, we can find victory in our homes, our churches, our communities, and help a lot of kids. And so we invite you to join us for a fun time of exploring the Bible for God's power for kids and families.
Also this afternoon in the chapel, there is going to be a seminar on depression and anxiety. We live in a world that is being overwhelmed by depression and anxiety. And Pat Smart is going to be sharing information about how we can turn this plague around both individually and what we can do in our world to make it a better and more secure place.
This afternoon, Theodore Lipthoff will also be presenting a seminar.
Yes, I guess mine will be the boring one. No, I'm just kidding. But if you're really interested in Adventist history and Ellen White, and you want to learn a little bit more of how we developed as a movement from a small group in the 19th century to a community of faith believers that across the globe, you're welcome to join the seminar. Why this is important? Because if you don't know your history, you don't know who you are. So if you want to find your identity, please come and join me. Thank you.
I'd also like to mention there have been some changes in the locations for the afternoon seminars. So don't depend on the Walla Walla Camp Meeting Bulletin. Look in the bulletin that you receive for today's church service. There is an insert in there that has the corrections. Pat Smart with Don't Worry, Be Happy, Understanding Managing Anxiety and Depression will be in the chapel, as already mentioned. Chuck is going to be in the youth room, Why Kids and Families Are Under Attack. That will be in the youth room. That's up the steps going east in the building here. And Search for Your Identity, Lessons from Seventh-day Adventist History will be in the fellowship hall also on this end of the building. And now, Mike, I think it's time for our children's feature.
Teacher Tammy, you're up.
Good morning, boys and girls, moms and dads. Oh, this is a wonderful, wonderful day, Sabbath, the best day of the week. When I lived on that little farm in North Dakota, we loved to go to church. Tiny little church there in Herdsfield, North Dakota. And in that little church, in that area, we had a little tiny church school with a big library. It was a bookcase about this long and about that tall. Big library. I always made sure I got to sit right next to it, because I like to read those books. And this is one book that I found to read. You know this one. Can you read it? I test? Well, I'll read it for you. Jungle Thorn. I read that book and read it again and read it again. I was so excited. A little girl, just sort of kind of my age, going through some tough times, but living for Jesus, and I wanted to be like that. So you know that on my farm, I like birds, and I was afraid of the cow and the goose and the chickens, and you know I went through a blizzard, and you know I learned to respect snakes later on, and I said I'd tell you a snake story this morning, and it has to do with this book, with Jungle Thorn. Later in my life, you never know where Jesus is going to ask you to go. I was asked to go to Borneo, the third largest island in the world. The very place I was asked to go was the school where Jungle Thorn walked to at the end of this book. Remember, the daddies came to get them because it wasn't quite finished yet, and so on, so on, so on, so on. I was asked to go there. I was so excited. And I got there, and I wanted so much to see the girl. Well, she was an old lady by then, the old lady with the glass eye. Has anybody seen an old lady with a glass eye? Her name's Kundima. I would ask and ask, and everybody would say, well, that's a name from here, but no, we don't know any old lady with a glass eye. So I just kept searching and searching. And after that trip, when I was in Singapore waiting to come back home to Walla Walla, a pastor from Sabah, which is where the school is, came there for pastor's meetings, and he saw me, and he says, Teacher Tammy, we found out something about Kundima, the old lady with the glass eye. I said, you did? He says, yes, I went to my board meeting after you left, and I said to all my board members at the little village of Togup, which I'd actually visited there, beautiful, beautiful place. He said, I asked my board members, do any of you know an old lady with a glass eye? Her name is Kundima. And one man did, with this arm, like Dr. McVeigh said this morning, use that when you need to. He raised his arm, and he said, she was my auntie. Oh, the pastor said, we never knew. We never knew. They did not know their own story. I brought many books of Jungle Thorn to share with them in their big school library there on their campus after that. But the next time I went back, I even got to meet Chaya. That's her name in the book, but her real name was Tengaha. She's this dear little old lady in this picture. I know it's tiny. This is another eye test. You can pass it around if you'd like. And I'm smiling so big, and she couldn't hear me because she was deaf. And I spoke English, and she spoke Dusun. But we both pointed up to heaven and said, we will see each other when Jesus comes, and we will be able to talk with each other. We were so happy. And I got to meet Mukit's daughter. The one in the blue shirt here, Mukut's real name was Timus, so her name is Arlene Timus. They go by the daddy's last name there when they grow up. And she was so excited. And she says, I want to come to school at Walla Walla. I said, you do? It's the best school. You've got to come. So she's thinking about this, and I'm encouraging her to come. But this picture I can't show you yet, because this one I met a little later. I'm going to get very excited, so watch out, Pastor Barnett. It's a very exciting story. And so when I went back there, I got to go to another place besides looking for my dear Kondima, who is resting now till Jesus comes. She went to sleep in Jesus when she was in her early 20s. But I went to a school on a mountain, on the side of another mountain. The school was on top of this little mountain. Well, sort of. It was a little ways down. My apartment was on top of that mountain. It was a teacher's apartment. And it had fence in the back and a fence on the side, and it had the wall of the apartment here, and then it had one place on the side of the cliff where I could go around from the backyard and down to the school. That was my one way to get to school from the backyard. That's important to remember. So I'd pray every morning and have worship right by my window that overlooked that little side cliff. And I was just having my worship and thanking Jesus for the day and asking me to be brave, because I was a chicken. You remember, I learned to respect snakes in Texas, and I was a chicken about some things. And so I had read that there were snakes there, but I asked the principal's wife when I got there, are there snakes here? And she says, no, just those things with those curvy tails. I said, scorpions? No problem. I'm not afraid of them. Well, I found out later her English wasn't as good as I thought it was. But anyway, I was reading there and studying at my Bible at the table, and I got up. I said, I've got to look for birds. This is Borneo, where they have lots of birds. They have birds that go, whoom, 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 when they fly. Oh, those are those rhinoceros hornbills, and I wanted to see one so much. So I went out the back door and locked it behind me, because remember, I was not going to go that way because there was a fence. I wasn't going to go that way. There was a fence. I was going to go around by the cliff and go down to the school. That's what I always did. So I'm listening to the birdies and I'm watching. It's very early and I'm thinking, oh, this is so exciting, but none of them are going whoom, oh, whoom, because they make so much noise. You know it's a rhinoceros hornbill and they're big. And so I was looking and all at once I heard a big squawk on the side over here, and I thought, whoa, I haven't heard that kind of sound from a bird before. So I went to the side of the building and I peeked around. Whoa, down in the ground, just about 8 feet away, was a great big brown and black rope looking thing. You remember I crawled over one of those under the school in Texas, and it was starting to uncoil just like that other one. And my stomach got that terrible uncoiling feeling, and I thought, oh, I'm so scared. Jesus, help me. I don't know what that snake is, but I'm afraid of that snake. And it kept uncoiling and uncoiling. I thought, is it going to come over here? Because I didn't know where to go. There were two fences and a cliff. And, well, I could have climbed a fence if that snake had come, I think. But the snake finally went down the cliff. About a meter of him. It was in a place they count by meters. And I watched till the last bit went. I knew it wasn't the rattlesnake. I never even looked for the tail. I just thought, oh, dear Jesus, now I've got to run. What if he comes back? But I had to give worship, and you have to be on time when you're doing worship. So I just said, Jesus, protect me. And I ran. I think I jumped across where that snake. You know, it was right under my window where I had breakfast. That's where it was there. The children used to come there and peek in the window at me and say, hi, Teacher Tammy, come play with. And it was right, oh, dear. So I just jumped and ran. I've got to tell the children. So I changed my worship story really quick. Guess what I changed it to? What? You don't know? Well, there's a story in the Bible about this great, big, beautiful snake. Yeah, that one. And so I changed it to that. Because I thought I could scream really well when it came to the screaming part, where there was supposed to be a screaming part, but Eve forgot that part. That was the problem. And so I told them about that beautiful snake, and the translator was saying that part, and I was saying it was up in the tree, and Satan was using the snake to talk to Eve. And here was Eve, our great-great-great-something grandmother, standing there by this tree, talking with a snake. What was wrong with that lady? She should have screamed and said, oh, Jesus. Oh, there was no Jesus name yet. She just should have said, God, help me. And she should have run. That's what she should have done. And so I did that scream, and all the children, and they said, there was a snake outside the window. Will you come and call to me in the morning? Don't go there. Don't peek there. The snake comes there too. And you know what? The principal's husband, the wife is translating, the one who said there are no snakes here, and her husband was the principal, and he says, well, what kind of snake was it? What color? I said, it was black and brown. I was starting from the head and going back to the body, just the way it uncoiled. And he said, oh, lopung, because I told him it was a meter long. Baby lopung. And I thought, what? He's not scared of this great big nasty, what is this? And everybody, I thought he must know what he's talking about. Maybe he even saw it sometimes. So everybody that asked me about the snake, they thought, oh, what a strange lady to scream about such a tiny little baby lopung. Ha! Huh. I was embarrassed, but that's not the first time. So when I finished all this wonderful stuff there in that land of jungle thorn, I went to the airport to fly back to Walla Walla, which is what everybody should do because it's the best. And when I went to the airport, there was this big row of books in the bookshop, and they were very expensive. But one said, Snakes of Borneo. And I thought, I wonder if I can find that on the internet when I get home. I don't think so. I'm going to pay some ringgit and buy that book. So I bought it. And I looked at it all the way home. Halfway home, somewhere over some ocean, I went, oh, and dropped the book right in the plane because I saw a picture of my snake. It was my snake. And it looked like this. I have permission from the man who took the picture to show it to children. I said, I'll never charge, I'll just scream. See? Isn't it black and brown? Yes, it is. It's got a brown head and the rest of it's black and it's about a meter long. And you know what it is? It's a belinotong. Doesn't that scare you? It wasn't the lopung. Well, I'll tell you its name in English then. It was a black spitting cobra. And they can spit like 6 feet. And they can also jab you with their fangs if they don't feel like spit. They can do a lot of things. And 1 meter of it is a full-grown one. I wrote a letter back to the school immediately and said to the principal and the wife, excuse me, that snake was not a baby lopung, it was a balinotong, and you must be careful with the children. And then, you know what the teacher said, she wrote to me, well, we did have a snake in our apartment. Their apartment was right next to mine. This is the lady who said there were no snakes there. And she said, we did have a snake in our apartment one time, but I thought it was a jumping rope because the children had, you know, they play with jumping ropes, and it was so colorful, and it was just there on the floor all. And I went to pick it up, and my angel said, don't. Not out loud, you know, angels don't usually, but she stopped. And she looked, and she said, oh, maybe it's a shule snake, the kind that bites the pigs, and then they die 3 seconds after they And she ran and got her husband, and sure enough, it was one of those, and it had turned over on its back, because they pretend they're dead, and they turn their backs when they're scared. And then they bite when you try to turn them over. And so she did not touch it, thanks to Jesus. They flipped it over, and he managed to, well, whatever you do with snakes that are in the wrong place. So I just thank Jesus, my darlings. And look, here's some advice. You know about advice, right? Right. Advice is, whenever you see an ad for vice, vice is a word that means bad stuff. You're supposed to say these words, and be sure you read your Bible before you do it. It is written, say that out loud. Say it again. It is written.
It is written.
Say it again. It is written. Thank you, lovey. Jesus said it 3 times because he knew what the Bible said. And we need to say it because we know what the Bible says about sin. And then we should run. Thank you.
Thank you. Our scripture today is found in Acts chapter 1, verses 8 through 11. That is something different than what the bulletin says. Again, it is Acts chapter 1, verses 8 through 11. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Now, when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven."
To tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take this sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. All my life was full of sin when Jesus found me. All my heart was full of misery and woe. Jesus placed his strong and loving arms about me, and he showed me in the way I ought to go. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take this sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Every day he comes to me with new assurance. More and more I understand his words of love. But I'll never know just why he came to save me, till one day I see his blessed face above. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so strong as he. No one else could take this sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Oh, how much he cared for me.
Amen. Thank you so much, Stan and Bill, for that beautiful piece. It's been wonderful to be together night by night, and I want to just pause for a moment and give a special thanks to Dr. John Brunt for being our featured speaker, Camp Meeting 2015. We could say a lot about him, but let me just cut to the quick. Beloved teacher of thousands who now spread around the world. Hundreds of pastors in training now serving also around the world. Author, homiletician, in other words, a preacher par excellence, esteemed theologian, critical thinker, and servant of God. It's been a pleasure to be here night by night, and now to have this final installment. And I can't help but ponder the words of the wise man who said, as cold waters to a thirsty soul, so is good news from a far country. Dr. Brunt has come from a far country, way down there in Southern California. And it's been like cold water to a thirsty soul, to my soul, and I've been blessed, and I just want to say thank you. And after Matt and Josie sing this special song, Dr. Brunt, if you don't mind, I'm going to come back up here with you for a moment, and I'm going to have a prayer for you, because Dr. Brunt is finishing his service, 50 years, I think, of service for God, and he goes home to deliver three more sermons, and then he's moving to Seattle, near his daughter and son-in-law and two grandkids and another son and daughter-in-law in Spokane. And I think it would be well for us to pray for God's blessing on him. So if you'd allow me, after Matt and Josie, thank you so much.
As the parched earth longs for rain, my soul thirsts for you. Do not turn me away, Lord. I am reaching out for you. I am longing for you. Hear my prayer, oh Lord. Give ear to my plea. I am not righteous, but you are righteous. Do not turn away from me. It's your grace I seek. Show me in the morning of your steadfast love and your mercy. Your mercy, and teach me the way to go, for I lift up my soul to you only, you only. Satisfy my soul, it's only to know you, and show me in the morning. morning of your steadfast love and your mercy, teach me the way to go, for I lift up my soul to you only, you only.
Show me your mercy. Show me your mercy in the morning, Lord.
Paul wrote a letter to Timothy. And this is a little reverse role here, Dr. Brunt, because you're more like Paul, I'm more like Timothy. Yeah. But I'm gonna take Paul's place for a moment. And I'd like to say what he said. He said, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not to me only, but to all those who long and love for his appearing. And so, Dr. Brunt, I know that, you know, you're not in prison. You're going to go on to a good service for God, but you certainly are finishing a wonderful time of service in a fully employed career and as a teacher, pastor, theologian. And we'd like to pray for God's blessing on you as you launch into a new
thank you
era. So let's pray together, friends. Dear Lord, thank you so much for your servant, Dr. Brunt. Thank you for his many years of service for you and his demonstration, his example that he set of someone who digs deeply into your word to understand and to know you better and then to tell us the good news, the wonderful hope we have in Jesus Christ. You've used him in a mighty way for many years. And now as he steps into a new role as retired teacher, theologian, pastor, and spends more time with family and friends, but still serving, of course, but we pray your anointing on him. Bless him, O Lord, in a mighty way, that in these years and this chapter, that he will experience the sunshine of your love and the smile of your grace. And bless him here this morning, as he speaks your word to us once again. Bless our hearts to hear and listen and respond and follow is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
Thank you so much, Jeff. There is absolutely nothing that does an old teacher's heart more good than seeing students doing so well. And to see Jeff and Michael and Lloyd and Chuck and Nancy all ministering and blessing their congregations where they serve, it is just a joy. So it's been an inspiring weekend. It was in a class up the street at the university. First day of class, 1 year, I had figured that I would spend most of the period on the logistics, you know, just the nitty-gritty stuff. What are the requirements? How are you going to be graded? And all of that. But I thought, before I do that, I'm just going to have a little icebreaker and ask a question for discussion. I thought we'd spend the first few minutes of class doing that. Here's the question I asked. Have any of you ever had dreams about the second coming of Jesus? I was not prepared for the response. We never got to the logistics of the class that day. It took the whole period. Hand after hand, telling the dreams that they had had about the second coming. And they were not just dreams, they were nightmares. I remember one student. He said that he dreamed that he and his mom and his dad and his brother and his sister were all standing, and they looked up in the sky and they saw that cloud about the size of a man's hand. And it got closer and closer, and they realized that Jesus was coming, and they were all so excited. And finally, they could recognize Jesus on the cloud, and he was there in the air. And all of a sudden, his mom and his dad and his sister all started rising from the ground, going up to meet the Lord in the air. But he and his brother stayed there, and they tried to jump. And they tried to catch on to the feet of their mom and dad and sister, but to no avail. And they went up, but the two of them were left standing there all alone. Another student dreamed that he was on a platform in a railroad station waiting for the train with a number of other people. The train came in, it stopped, the conductor got off and had a clipboard, and with his clipboard started calling out names. First name, and that person got on the train, and then the second name. And after a while, the crowd started thinning as more and more names were called, and the people got on the train. And then it got down to the place where there were only a few people left, and then only a handful, and down to 5, 4, 3, and 2. And the conductor called the other person's name, and that person got on. And then the conductor said, "All aboard!" And he ran up to the conductor. And at that point, he realized that the conductor was Jesus. And he said, "I'm supposed to be on this train too." And Jesus looked at the list and said, "I'm sorry, you're not here." Got on the train, closed the door. The train took off out of the station as he stood there all by himself on the platform. And after it went out of the station a ways, the whole train lifted up and started going up into the sky. And he stood there on the platform alone, crying. And he woke up from the dream, and he really was crying. Paul says that the second coming of Jesus is a joyful hope. But as I listened to the students for that entire hour, it did not sound like a joyful hope. It sounded like a fearful dread. There were 40 students in that class, and only one of them had ever had a positive dream about the second coming of Jesus. Why is it that the second coming isn't a joyful hope in the dreams of our young people? I believe our text for today tells us something that should make the second coming a joyful hope, a joyful hope for everyone. We've already heard the text from Acts 1. It's a familiar text. You remember the setting. Jesus has risen. He has appeared to his disciples now several times, and now they have a question for him. Is this the time? They've been looking forward to the kingdom, and now they want to know, is this the time? And Jesus says, it's not for you to know the times, the times that the Father has set by his own authority. Your job is to be witnesses. To be witnesses for me in Jerusalem, and then all around Judea, and then on up to Samaria, those people the Jews didn't like much, and then to the very ends of the earth. And after he gave them that commission, he was lifted up And he went up into the clouds, and they were watching. And you remember these two men in white came and stood beside them and said, "Why are you gazing up there?" This same Jesus is going to come back as you have seen him go. Those three words ought to do away with second coming nightmares. This same Jesus. We have come to know the Jesus of the Gospels. And it is this same Jesus who is going to return. It is not a different Jesus. It is not a Jesus who is scary. It is this same Jesus. Let's remember who this Jesus is. Think of Matthew chapter 9, verse 36. Jesus looked around the crowds, and Matthew says he had compassion on them. And then he healed. The Jesus of the Gospels is a compassionate Savior. And it is this same Jesus of compassion who is coming again. And that is good news. Think about Mark chapter 10. For the third time within three chapters, Jesus predicts that he is going to die. The disciples have a hard time accepting that, and they don't really get it. They immediately go on to argue about who's going to be first in the kingdom. And then Jesus lets them know that even though the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them and their great men exercise authority over them, it will not be so with them. Whoever's going to be first will be a slave of all. And then Jesus says, "For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." The Jesus of the Gospels is a Jesus who gives his life for us. And it is this same Jesus who is coming back, and that is good news. Think about John chapter 5. John 5, 24. Jesus wants to give assurance to his disciples. And he tells them, if they hear his word and believe in the one who sent him, in other words, put their trust in God, that they have eternal life. He doesn't say you will have eternal life in the future. He says you have eternal life, and you don't face the judgment because you have already passed from death to life. What kind of assurance? Jesus is an assuring Savior. That same Jesus of assurance is the Jesus who's coming again, and that is good news. Notice that he says, you have eternal life. I think a lot of the reason why young people have such a hard time feeling scared about the second coming is they just don't feel that they can ever be quite good enough. But we're not saved because we are good enough. We're saved because we put our trust in the only one who could ever be good enough. Think about John chapter 11. Jesus' best friend Lazarus dies. And you remember that both of Lazarus' sisters said to Jesus, "If you had only been here," which was a way of saying, "Jesus, why weren't you here?" And Jesus went to the tomb and he wept. An empathetic Savior. The Jesus of the Gospels is a Jesus of empathy. And this same empathetic Jesus is the one who is coming again. And that is good news. Go on a few verses and Jesus says, "Lazarus, come forth." The Jesus of the Gospels is a Jesus of power, who has power over death, who can swallow death up in victory. The Jesus who is coming again is the Jesus who has power over death, and that is good news. Think of Luke 23. Jesus there on the cross. He has been tortured and beaten and mocked and spit upon. And he looks down on the people who did all of that. And he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The Jesus of the Gospels is a Jesus of forgiveness. And this same forgiving Jesus is the one who's going to come again, and that is good news. When we understand who Jesus is, there should be no fear. We should not be worrying about the end. We should be looking forward with joyful hope, as Paul says. We don't need to worry about the future. One day I was with my two Seattle grandsons. They're now 7 and 10. At this time they were just 2 and 5. And they both came and they climbed up on my lap, one on each knee, and they gave me a book and they said, read to us. It was a Sesame Street book. Grover, that character on Sesame Street. The title of the book was The Monster at the End of This Book, starring lovable, furry old Grover. And there's a picture of Grover on the front, and when you open and look at the first page, Grover is there, and Grover says, I'm scared of monsters. Did you see what's on the front of the book? There's a monster at the end of this book. That scares me. And you turn the page, and Grover says, shh, I've got an idea. Don't turn the page. And then we won't get to the end of the book. And after I read that page, I asked my grandsons, should I turn the page? Grover doesn't want us to. And they said, turn the page. And then Grover yells out on the next page, you turned the page. You weren't supposed to do that. Please don't turn the page. There's a monster at the end of this book. And I asked them, should I turn the page? And they said, yes, turn the page. And so I turned the page. And with each page, Grover gets more afraid and more panicked. And he implores and begs and pleads, don't turn the next page. And you finally get to the next to the last page, and he says, please, please, please. Should I turn the page? The boys laughed and said, yes. And when you turn the page, there is no monster. It's just Grover himself. Furry and lovable. He didn't need to worry all the way. Folks, we don't need to worry about the pages of history turning, because we're headed for good news. This same Jesus is coming back again. So what do we do in the interim? Well, Jesus tells us at the beginning of this passage. The disciples want to know about the time. Their question is, when? Is this the time? And Jesus says, it's not for you to know the time. And you know what? We've been trying to figure out the time ever since. You've seen the charts. I've seen so many of those charts, I really don't ever want to see another chart again. Everyone's a little different, and people have their idea of when Jesus is going to come from these events. Our pastoral staff kept a list 1 year. We decided we would just see how many people came to us in the course of a year with present truth they had knowing when Jesus was going to come. Or maybe not the exact date, but they knew it was going to be by such and such a date. And that year we had 9 different people come. And every one of them told us, it is absolutely necessary that you get up in front of the church and tell people this, because this is present truth and the people need to know it. Well, of course, we did not. And every one of those 9 dates passed. That doesn't mean Jesus isn't coming soon, but it means it's not for us to know the times and the seasons. Jesus says, you won't know the day or the hour. I said that to one of these people, and they said, oh, it says the day or the hour, but it doesn't say we won't know the month and the year, and I've got that figured out. We have spent way too much time on our charts trying to figure out the end and not nearly enough time talking about Jesus who is coming. We've spent way too much time talking about last day events instead of talking about the person who comes and rescues us in the last day. Our job is not to figure out the time. Our job is not to put together the events. Our job is not to try to show people how terrible the world is. They know that. One time way back in 1888, they had a minister's conference before the general conference that year, and Ellen White heard a sermon on Friday night that she didn't like. She didn't say anything there. She was too kind for that, but she wrote a letter back to her daughter-in-law, Mary. And she said, at the commencement of the Sabbath, Elder Farnsworth preached a most gloomy discourse. She said, he put together all the iniquities of the world, and there was no light, no good cheer in it. A couple days later, they asked her to speak to the pastors about preaching. And she didn't mention that sermon, but you know she had it in mind because she used some of the same language in talking about preaching that she had used in that letter to her daughter-in-law, Mary. And she told the preachers, don't bundle together all of the bad news and iniquity that you can find. Just point people to Jesus. And she said, then you can hang pictures in the halls of people's memory that will be beautiful pictures and will cause them to unfold and reach up to heaven. Our job is to give the good news so that people unfold and reach up to heaven and see that there is joyful hope in this world. And our job is not only to proclaim Jesus, but it is to model and show Jesus' kingdom. You remember Jesus told what the kingdom is all about. He stood there in that synagogue in his hometown of Nazareth, and he said that he had come to give good news to the poor and release to the captives. We are here to make God's kingdom real to people as we give good news to the poor and feed the hungry and give release to the captives. We model the kingdom as we already begin in our lives and in our work for others and our love for them to sing the songs of Zion so that people will recognize them when Jesus comes. We give people a taste of the kingdom now. Our job is to be witnesses for Jesus and model his kingdom. And if we do that, the second coming should not be a fearful dread. It should be a joyful hope, because this same Jesus who is our friend is coming back. I want to ask you a question. I hesitate to do this because in answering you will show your age. But how many of you can remember when down the street at the campus of Walla Walla University there was a big building called Columbia Auditorium? Wow, lots of hands. You remember that building. It's been a few years now. You remember that it went up in flames in a horrible fire set by an arsonist. It was a grand old building, great acoustics. Van Cliburn had played there. I'll never forget the night that a young violinist I had never heard of before, only 25 years old, just absolutely amazed us. And now Itzhak Perlman is a household name. But someone set it on fire. It was not the first fire he had set that night. He had set a couple of other fires. We got the kids up out of bed and went to those fires, and by the time we got there, the fire was out. When we took the kids back home and put them to bed, they told us in no uncertain terms, do not get us out of bed again unless we're really going to see a fire. Well, they really did see a fire later that night. It was way in the middle of the morning, between 2 and 3, I think. We heard our neighbor, Fred Bennett, who was the head of the volunteer fire department, rushing out of his house, and we knew that there must be another fire. So we went and looked out our front door, the porch, and we could see smoke coming from what looked like the campus. Well, we remembered that the kids had said, "Don't you dare wake us up again unless we're really going to see a fire." So we didn't wake them up. But we were very curious, so we decided that I would stay there and Ione would take our car, which was a Chevrolet, and drive it over to the campus, see what was going on, and then come back and tell me, and we'd see whether we should get up or not, get the kids up or not. Well, she left. I stood there watching the smoke, and all of a sudden the smoke gave way to these huge flames. And I was very curious, and I knew that even though I couldn't see from where I was, there was a spot just down the block where I could get a view through to the campus and see what building it was that was on fire. So I thought, I will keep watch of the house. I won't be out of sight of the house where the kids are sleeping. And I got on my bicycle and I rode down the street to that place where I could see the campus. Just about then, a car turned onto our street. I could see that it was a Chevrolet, so I assumed that Ione was coming back. I thought, well, I'll turn around, ride back to the house, and meet her. Well, I was right, it was a Chevrolet. I was wrong, it wasn't my wife. It was the College Place policeman. He was out looking for strange suspects who might be riding bicycles the opposite direction of the fire at 3 o'clock in the morning. And so he stopped me and he asked what I was doing out there riding my bicycle. And I told him the perfectly logical story that I just told you. And he wasn't buying it. At one point he said, "You thought I was your wife? Do I look like your wife?" And I wanted to say, "I'm sure glad you don't," but I didn't. Well, I kept trying to explain, but then I got really worried when he walked over to the car, got his radio, and said, "I have a suspect in custody. I need reinforcements for the arrest." And pretty soon, another police car came zipping up the street, lights flashing, and it came to a screeching halt beside the other one, and the policeman jumped out. And he was a friend of mine. One of my students, actually. He was not anxious to see this ordeal continue any longer and let the other policeman know I was okay. I'll tell you, it felt really good to have a friend come to the rescue at that point. I was glad to see him. We live in a world that's full of turmoil, a world that is full of trouble. But our friend Jesus is coming to the rescue. And we can look forward to that with hope, because it is good news that this same Jesus that we have come to know and love in the Gospels is the Jesus who is coming back, our friend, to rescue us. Lord God, we are so grateful for the hope that we have in Jesus. We're grateful that this same Jesus is coming back. May hope burn in our hearts as we witness for him. In Jesus' name, amen.